Let's call upon our awesome King. Blessed are the people who know the sound of the shofar. In the light of your countenance, O Yahweh, shall they walk. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu, melech haolam, asher kitchiyanu bevitzotov etzivanu, lismoach ol shofar. Blessed are you, O Yahweh, our Elohim, King of the universe, who sanctified us by your commandments and has commanded us to hear the voice of the shofar.
Omer together, all together. Blessed are you, Yahweh our Elohim, King of the universe, who has sanctified us with his commandments and commanded us to count the Omer. Today is the fourth day of the Omer. Next one. Elohim, be gracious to us and bless us and cause his face to shine upon us, that your way may be known on the earth, your salvation among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O Elohim. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy. For you will judge the peoples with uprightness and guide the nations on the earth. Let the peoples praise you, O Elohim. Let all the peoples praise you. The earth has yielded its produce. Elohim, our Elohim, blesses us. Elohim blesses us that all the ends of the earth may fear him. Amen.
Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Baruch Shem Kevod, Malkuto, Leolam Ba'ed. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. Blessed is his name and his glorious kingdom forever. And Yahweh spake unto Moses, saying, Speak thou also unto the children of Israel, saying, Verily my Sabbath you shall keep, for it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that ye may know that I am Yahweh that doth sanctify you. Wherefore the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath, to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations for a perpetual covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days Yahweh made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. Ve'ahavta et Yahweh Eloheka, v'kol levavka, v'kol nafshika, v'kol me'odeka, ve'hayu hadevarim ha'ele, asher elokim etzavka hayom al levaveka, v'shinantam levaneka, v'dibartabam v'shivtika v'viteka, v'vlekteka v'derek, Ushakbika, Uvikumeka, Ukshartam, Leodel Yodeka, Vehayu, Lotodafot Beneneka, Uktaftam, El Mesazot Beteka, Uvishareka, Vehaftalareka Kamoka. You shall love Yahweh your Elohim with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. These words which I am commanding you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontals on your forehead. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Amen.
All right, if we'll all extend our hands toward the treasure chest and children, Scarlett's going to lead us in our blessing.
Abba, open your eyes and see your truth. In Yeshua's name, amen.
And all together say, by his grace, not one will be lost. Amen.
May Yahweh protect and defend you. May he always shield you from shame. May you come to be Israel a shining day. May you be like Ruth and Ephraim. May you be deserving of praise.
protect and defend you. May Yahweh preserve you his way. Favor them, O Yah, with happiness and peace. O hear our Sabbath prayer.
Yeah.
You shall say before Yahweh your Elohim, I have removed the sacred portion from my house, and also have given it to the Levite and the alien, the orphan and the widow. According to all your commandments which you have commanded me, I have not transgressed or forgotten any of your commandments. I have not eaten of it while mourning, nor offered any of it to the dead. I have listened to the voice of Yahweh my Elohim. I have done according to all that you have commanded me. Look down from your holy habitation from heaven and bless your people Israel and the ground which you have given us, a land flowing with milk and honey, as you swore to our fathers. Amen.
Baruch Adonai, humble rock. Baruch Adonai, humble rock, Leolam Baed. Baruch Adonai, humble rock, Leolam Baed. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher barakah banu mikol ha'amim, v'natan lanu et Torato. Baruch atah Adonai, noten ha'Torah. Amen. Bless Yahweh the Blessed One. Blessed is Yahweh the Blessed One for all eternity. Blessed are you, O Yahweh, our Elohim, King of the universe, who has chosen us from all peoples and given us his Torah. Blessed are you, O Yah, giver of the Torah. Amen.
So when my little wife found out that I was teaching, she was just clamoring for a chance to get up here with me.
Sure. Should have brought a mom joke, broke the ice.
So as we started going along, I felt from the beginning like this was a dual teaching, because our Father is complete. And sometimes we hear from a man's perspective or a woman's perspective or whatever, but I really feel like that with, as we go into the message, we're going to be reviewing the Ten Commandments. And we're going to put them in a little bit of a chiastic structure, but we also want to demonstrate from both the male psyche and the female psyche, because I think that's how he would have given his commandments, was incompleteness. So the title of the message is How Guarding the Commandments Will in Turn Guard You. We have to understand that our foundation is his Torah, his word. Psalm 11:3 says, if the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? Why did Yeshua say that loving God and loving your neighbor is what all of the Torah hinges upon? So as I thought about that, and I thought about some of these things, we often talk about the Ten Commandments as the top 10 list. When I looked at it from what actually happened in the wilderness at this time frame, as they were, now, they would have just come out of Egypt, they were heading somewhere, they were going somewhere. So Yahweh was demonstrating to them how he had them. So he was building his case as they were going through the wilderness, and as they were walking, and as they were hungering, and as they were thirsting, and their shoes not wearing out, their clothes not wearing out, all of these things, as he sustained them, he was demonstrating to them that he could, that he was able to take care of the congregation. And so after he demonstrated to them, and after he proved to them, I've got this, then is whenever he gave these words, and he gave them in his own voice to his congregation. And it's the first time that he addressed corporately his whole congregation in the wilderness. After he had formed Israel into a nation, into a congregation, he brings them out. And I just thought, you know what? The first thing that he said to them had to be really important. And it had to validate and verify everything that he had been doing up to that point. So I'm not trying to just do a singular teaching here, so whatever you have to say, please feel free. So,
just don't mess up, you won't have to correct.
So would you read for us Exodus 20, 1 through 5?
Then Yahweh spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the place of slavery. Do not have other gods besides me. Do not make an idol for yourself, whether in the shape of anything in the heavens above or on the earth below or in the waters under the earth. Do not bow and worship to them and do not serve them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, bringing the consequences of the father's iniquity on the children to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me.
But showing faithful love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. Do not misuse the name of Yahweh your Elohim, because Yahweh will not leave anyone unpunished who misuses his name. Remember Shabbat to keep it holy. Now, I'm going to pause from the reading for just a second, and I'm going to give you all a little bit of a personal thing that happened to us recently. So, if you look in Leviticus, he goes through and he lists his feasts, and he says, these are my Sabbaths, which you shall proclaim. These are not Jewish days. These are not Jewish feasts. These are not something that another culture does. These are his Sabbaths, Amen. His feasts, that we shall proclaim. Who's we? If we're his people, if we're saying that we're called by his name, if we want to be called Christian, which is basically to say little Christs. That's what the word Christian means. Now, I know we're Hebrew roots, and I know that that's probably a misnomer and something that I probably stepped out in that may give pause to some people. But that's what the name was referred to, and somebody that was a real Christian in the past was somebody that actually lived it 7 days a week. So a believer is one that believes. You can't be a good salesman unless you believe in your product. So if we're his, and if he's given us reason to believe in him, then we should be doing everything we can to sell this walk to the people that we come in contact with joy, with giving them fruit, with doing what's right in front of them. So, a little over a week ago, I called a mechanic, and I asked him to order certain parts for a breakdown that I knew was coming in my truck. And he said those parts are common order parts. They're on the shelf. Good deal. 2 days later, take my truck, drop it off in the evening. The next morning, I called him. Did you get everything you needed? Well, went to pick up the parts, and they weren't there. They had to order them. They're not going to be in until Monday. Well, guess what's Monday? Passover. So I knew that there was no way that he was going to get through with my truck in one day. So I thought, well, and this is my humanness, I'm thinking, well, I won't bring that leaven back on my property without cleaning it out. So when I go to pick it up Tuesday, Wednesday, or whenever, I'll clean it out before I bring it home.
So first of all, let me back up just a little bit. We put it in on Wednesday. It was supposed to be out latest on Friday. He was going to clean the truck out on Sunday. And then when that didn't happen, I told him, you have to go to the mechanic and clean out your truck before Passover.
So she was trying to be my Holy Spirit, which was good, because that's why the Lord put me with her. But she said, you're going to go down there and clean it up on his property. And I said, well, it'll inconvenience him, and it'll this, and it'll that. And I'm kind of doing a little bit of squirming. And she's like, this is a question to you? And I said, well, no, it's not really. But the rest of the story is Tuesday is a Shabbat. And so I knew that if I went down there and cleaned my truck out, that I was also going to have to tell him about the Shabbat that comes on Tuesday. And I also never put my truck in intentionally over a feast. So if I put my truck in on a Shabbat, I'm redoing everything that they do. Or they mess it up and it costs me more later, or whatever the case is. So I don't have my stuff, and I'm not judging anybody that does, but I've just already got my own butt whoopings for this. So I don't put my truck in the shop over his Sabbaths. because it says, you shall not make your servant work, neither shall you work. You shall not make your animals work. It is a Sabbath rest for the land. It is, so all of this stuff. So, and again, I'm not telling anybody else not to do whatever they do, but I know for us, we have been dealt with on this issue, not very nicely, several times, because I didn't learn the first time. So, when she said, you've got to go clean it out, I'm thinking, and I got to tell him about Tuesday. Well, that was not something that she thought about. So I go down there, and I clean my truck out, and I walked around the building, and I found the proprietor, and I said, hey, Tuesdays, you know, Tuesdays are Shabbat. So he said, now, y'all are Seventh-day Adventist, aren't you? How is that? You know, they just know, you know. So I said, well, you know, we do go to church on Saturday. We're not Seventh-day Adventists. We do keep the feasts. Passover and Easter are two different, totally different things. There's not 3 days between Friday and Sunday. And so when you look at it like that, you know, Tuesday is the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And we're told to hold it as a Sabbath. So I don't work on that day, and I don't ask anyone else to work on that day either. And I said, now,
on
my stuff, or for me. And so whenever I told him that, he said, oh, I gotcha. Wow, that really takes a lot of pressure off of me. And I'm going,
we're not going to have the truck on Wednesday, are we?
So she didn't know any of this conversation was happening. So I call her up and I said, hey, I said, truck's clean, everything's great. And we're probably not going to see our truck until Thursday or Friday of next week. And she said, what? And so that's where when the Father, go ahead. That's where when the Father puts us together, you know, she gave me a prompting. So he used her to be my Holy Spirit, which was right. And it helped to reinforce, and that's what the Father wants to do with our marriages and with our families, is he wants to put people together that will prop each other up to do the right things. So that's what a wholesome, godly marriage is supposed to do. Not tear each other down, but to motivate each other to do more. So I called her on the phone and told her, and a little bit later she called me back, or I called her back for something else, and I said, what's wrong? She said, well, it's just a lot. And the thing is, it is just a lot. But that's where either we believe this or we don't.
I'll tell you the rest of the story a little down the message. It'll fit in later.
You want to start with nine?
You are to labor 6 days and do all your work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath to the Lord your God. You must not do any work. You, your son or your daughter, your male or your female servant, your livestock, or the resident alien who is within your city gates.
For Yahweh made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and everything in them in 6 days. Then he rested on Shabbat. Therefore the Lord blessed the seventh day and declared it holy. Honor your father and your mother so that you may have a long life in the land that Yahweh your Elohim is giving you. The bridge between respect for authority and humanity is that commandity. I just made up a word. That commandment, the commandment to honor our father and our mother, it couples divine authority with human interaction. That's why that one is... because I never believe that there's one reason why. But that is one of the reasons why he says this is a commandment with promise. Because if you respect other people and you respect his authority, then that puts you a leg ahead of anyone who does not. Do not murder. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not give false testimony against your neighbor. Do not covet your neighbor's house. Do not covet your neighbor's wife, his male or female servant, his ox or his donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. So as you look at this list, there is a way to put these things together chiastically. And it's really interesting whenever you start taking the first commandment and you start coupling these things together with the last commandment. And that's what basically was the inspiration for the message. I don't know if this thing's going to sit up here or not. But so basically, if you take, I am Yahweh, you shall not covet. How does that go together? So this is what's very interesting. Number one, understanding that Yahweh is our God and our provider will reduce our temptation or eliminate our temptation to covet, because we will be secure and content in what He has provided for us. Exodus 20, verse 1, I am Yahweh your Elohim who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the place of slavery. Do not have other gods besides me. Now, Jephthah understood this whenever he was leading the Israelites against the Ammonites. And basically, the Ammonites king said, hey, you dudes need to return the land that you took from our fathers. And Jephthah wrote a letter back and he said, hold up a second. Judges 11, 24, isn't it true that you can have whatever your god Chemosh conquers for you, and we can have whatever Yahweh conquers for us? So don't covet our land. Chemosh isn't doing for you what you want to do. Step on over to the Lord's side, maybe you'll get what you want. Now, I'm not saying that to say that we should try to get what we want from being on His side, but what I'm saying is when our desire is for Him, then we're happy with the things that He provides for us. Do not covet your neighbor's house. Do not covet your neighbor's wife, his male or his female servant. If I understand that everything that I have is a gift from Him, what is a gift? A gift is somebody that gives of their own volition. I mean, it's something that someone gives of their own volition. So if I'm reaching for something that's not been given to me by my God, then I'm putting another God or another image or another something in front of Him to supply my needs. So that's what this commandment, that's how these two commandments go together. Number two, deceiving ourselves and misrepresenting who Yahweh is undermines our integrity and opens the door for bearing false witness. Do not make an idol for yourself, whether in the shape of anything in the heavens above or on the earth below or in the waters under the earth. Do not bow in worship to them and do not serve them, for I, Yahweh, am your Elohim, a jealous God, bringing the consequences of the father's iniquity on the children to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me, but showing faithful love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commands. Vindicate me. Psalm 26:1 says this, vindicate me, Yahweh, because I have lived with integrity and have trusted in Yahweh without wavering. Test me, Yahweh, and try me, examine my heart and my mind. So everything that David is saying here is, you can see the integrity of my heart. You can see that all the way through to the core, I'm the same. I'm the same material. I'm pure gold all the way to the center. I'm not rotten. I am what I am. Do not give false testimony against your neighbor. We should live our lives this way. If we are intent on representing Him well, then we also will not be nearly as likely to misrepresent other true facts in our lives. Number three, stealing is demonstrating to others that we don't believe that Yahweh is capable of providing for us, which is exactly the opposite of what He taught His people in the wilderness. Did He not provide for them manna? Did He not provide for them clothing? Did He not provide for them water? Did He not do everything that they needed for their basic needs? So stealing undermines the very identity and the very promises that he gave to us. So when he says, I will take care of you, I will do for you, and then when we steal or when we cheat in business to get something that we think should be ours or whatever the case is, these are soft stealing, but it's still stealing. Like, you can name it whatever you want to, but you can even take it into undermining somebody else's integrity if they're trying to sell something to you and try to get something for less than what the value of it is. And if you know that you're doing that, then Yahweh can address those issues in our lives. You can do, there's a lot of different things, whether it's taxes, whether it's, you know, there's a lot of different things. But we've got to believe that he will provide for us as long as we honor his name. But we don't undermine his name and say, well, you're not giving me enough, so therefore I'm going to stretch my own hand out and take it, so that, because we're telling ourselves that he's not capable. That's a lie. If we're going to lie to ourselves, we're going to lie to anybody else. Do not give false test. So stealing is the opposite of what he taught his people in the wilderness. He is capable of providing for us. Exodus 20 and verse 7 says, do not misuse the name of Yahweh or Elohim, because Yahweh will not leave anyone unpunished who misuses his name. And then Proverbs 30 and verse 8 says, keep falsehood and deceitful words far from me. And in the same verse, it says, give me neither poverty nor wealth. Feed me with the food I need. Otherwise, I might have too much and deny you, saying, who is Yahweh? Or I might have nothing and steal, profaning the name of my God. So David, or Asaph, I can't remember, or no, this is actually Proverbs. So Solomon understood the correlation here between his name and theft. The Sabbath is a sign between us and Yahweh, showing him and others who we belong to. Keeping the commandments that govern our relationship with Yahweh directly affects how we keep the commandments that govern our relationship with each other. So one of the things that was interesting, and I don't think I pointed this out before, but these commandments that are chiastically structured together, one of them deals with our relationship with Yahweh, and one of them deals with our relationship with other people. And so if we honor him first and foremost in our life, most of the time that's going to take care of the relational issues that we have with each other. Remember Shabbat to keep it holy. Labor 6 days and do all your work. The seventh day is a Sabbath. This one is actually linked to, and Halisa can do so much of a better job with this than I can, but the idea of adultery and idolatry being linked, I think, comes from this passage. But adultery, in Ezekiel 20, in verse 16, it says, because they rejected my ordinances, profaned my Sabbaths, and did not follow my statutes, for their hearts went after their idols. So when we follow our heart out of Shabbat, then we're adulterating the faith. So now I'm not saying anything against someone who is walking a victorious Christian life who has never heard about the Sabbath. If they've never heard about the Sabbath, never read about it, never gone through the commandments and all of that, haven't been awakened, that's different. But when we know and when we read it and when we're awakened to it, we're responsible. And at that point, you have a choice to make. So the Sabbath is linked with adultery. Parents are the first authority structure in our lives. Honoring them forces us to think of others over ourselves. The ultimate disrespect for another person is to deny them the right to live. Murder is the most selfish act that a person can commit. Honor your father and your mother so that you may have a long life in the land that Yahweh is giving you. So I threw the murder thing in there because of he correlates honoring your father and your mother with respect for him, respect for each other. And then he says, if you do this, you'll have a long life. So if you don't do this, if you ultimately disrespect somebody else, you'll cut their life short. And what does he say? He says, he that sheds man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed. So that's one of the things that he has set up is in his Torah, that's how it's supposed to work. Each of you is to respect his mother and father. You are to keep my Sabbaths. I am Yahweh. So that was the bulk of what I felt like the Father had given me personally. And as I was sharing some of this stuff with Hannah, this is where she'll probably be on the mic more than I am at this in this last part, because a lot of these notes came from her.
So I was sharing something with him from my quiet time, and I was so excited about it because it wasn't something I had seen, or if I had seen it, it was obviously just something I needed to see again, which we'll go back to the story that we'll finish. So that's how I ended up here, is because I opened my mouth and shared something from my quiet time. So the Ten Commandments are our ketuvah, which we've just walked through Passover, new beginnings. Very grateful for that. The Ten Commandments were given to the children of Israel to know how to live. We do our best, obviously, to live by these every day. We do fail, but we do strive. And he's so good to us that he shows us what to do to show him love. And that's what I try to tell my children.
Go clean your truck out.
Yeah, exactly. If people ask me, why do you feel like you have to keep the commandments, is that's one of the first things I answer, is not because it wasn't done away with. It's he says, if you love me, you will continue to keep my commandments. So the children of Israel were delivered out of Egypt. Obviously, they still had some Egypt in them because they continued to complain through their journey. So we all know that as we walk through his feasts and cycles, we too can have the Egypt in us. And he brings us through testing to reveal our weakness so that we can address them, but also to reveal his strength. So when he called me and said, hey, I went to clean out the truck, I was like, that's fantastic. You got it done. It's off of our radar now. And then when he said, and I told him not to work on Tuesday. Of course, I didn't want him to work on it on Tuesday. That was the whole point of putting the truck in there the week before. My distraughtness was just like, oh my word, it's still in there. And now it still can't be worked on. And then I realized that that was the Egypt to me. Like, I wasn't going to tell him to work on it, but it's his shop, so if he was going to work on it, it's not me working on it. And I tried to get it in there early, and then that's why I was weeping. My poor mom had to help me process that, of just like, oh my goodness, now it's really not going to be out. And here at this point, you're out of work for 9 days, plus a mechanic bill, and it was just a little overwhelming.
And if I could just insert here too, one of the things that made it that much harder was we're coming off of an uncharacteristically slow month. So when I tell you Yahweh knows how to put pressure on you specifically, wherever you are, he knows. He designed us, he created us, and he knows exactly how to spotlight and highlight and pinpoint the things that will give us pause. Mm-hmm. And if I could, I want to share this story.
Yeah, absolutely.
So someone last week, we were going through the food line, and someone looked at me and he said, you won't ever believe what happened yesterday. And I said, I'd like to hear it. And he said, Monday morning, get to work. Projects that were supposed to have been finished over the weekend were left undone. So this man goes to the people that he's in charge of, and he said, let's get this done, knocked out today, all this kind of stuff. Well, about three or four of them had headaches or other things that they had to early out for, or this and that and whatever. So they were all going to leave work early on that day. So this man's supervisor looked at him and he said, well, at least you'll be here, won't you? And he said, right then and there, he said, I'm thinking, well, there are two Passovers. You know, I could just plan for that second Passover. And he said, you know what? He said, that's not what that second Passover's for. And so he made the decision. He said, right then and there to that supervisor, he said, I have to leave at 2 o'clock. Like, that's what where I have to be. I have to go. And so it's getting close to the time for him to leave. He's walking around making sure all the loose ends are tied up before he cuts out. All these guys that had to early out are still there. So he walks up to the one. He said, man, he said, I thought you had a bad headache. You were going to have to go home. He said, man, I started feeling better just almost right after I talked to you. And one by one, and so all that was for that man to say, I'm going to be faithful to you. And so because of that, it's a huge encouragement to me when I hear these testimonies of people that are sitting in here walking these things out in their personal lives. This stuff's not child's play. This stuff's not easy. What are they going to think of me? I've only been here for a short time. I don't have the seniority to do whatever I want to do. One year I was taking off for Sukkot, and the man was supposed to give me a company truck. Well, emergency situation came up. You're going to have to be here. Well, not going to be. I've got to go off to his feast. Well, you or Jesus one better show up because we got pipe delay. I looked at him. I said, well, I guess Jesus better be here then because I'm going to be over there where I'm supposed to be. And he looked at me and he said, you're really that serious about that? I said, look, if I let down my guard on these things, there's no lengths that I won't, no depths that I won't stoop to. I said, if you like me who I am and how I am, I've got to honor him first, and that's who you'll get. Otherwise, I don't know what's going to happen.
So after I had my meltdown, I did pray and ask Yahweh to forgive me, and I thanked him also for showing me that that was in my heart. And then he just gave me an overwhelming peace that it's going to be okay. It doesn't matter if it's in there the rest of the week. It was almost in there the rest of the week. It's okay. But in my Torah portion, I was reading in Exodus.
I wondered why it took that long for it to come out.
I know, right? I was thinking it was my fault. But so Exodus 20, verse 20 says, and Moses said to the people, do not fear, for Yahweh has come to test you, and that his fear may be before you so that you may not sin. And it just was like, oh my goodness, like he tests us there in this time. And to show himself strong, but also to get the Egypt out of us. And I cross-referenced that verse, and then that's where I was just blown away, and I was just telling Steve, I was like, I'm so encouraged because I had not seen that. And it cross-referenced to Isaiah 41:10. Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will hold on to you with my righteous right hand. For I am the Lord your God who holds your right hand, who says to you, do not fear, I will help you. And also, you are to regard only the Lord of armies as holy. Only he should be feared. Only he should be held in awe. And I was just like, everybody needs to hear this because, like, I know a lot of people, BJ and Christina with their truck, different people with health, back problems, poor Jared falling down and breaking his ribs, you know, different ones of us going through these testings that we don't have to dread the season of testing that he will hold on to us. And you want to read that one?
Mm-hmm. Isaiah 40, 28 to 31. Do you not know? Have you not heard? Yahweh is the everlasting God, the creator of the whole earth. He never becomes faint or weary, and there is no limit to his understanding. He gives strength to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Youths may become faint and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who trust in Yahweh will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not become weary. They will walk and not faint. Now, in Psalm 1, it says, blessed is the man that does not walk in the path of sinners. Are we supposed to be running a race?
Yes.
Does it sometimes feel like we need a break? But he strengthens the weak, and he upholds the feeble, and he gives strength to the powerless. So it's not time to walk. It's time to keep on running.
So when he was telling me what he was going to teach, and then I was sharing this, I was like, if anything I could do to leave Yahweh's people with today would be to be encouraged that there's new beginnings, this is a new feast, and what we sow in Passover, we reap at Sukkot. And so we want to go into this season with joy, and we can because he is the one who's upholding us with his right hand through all of these testings. And even though some of the junk comes out and you cry, and you can repent and keep moving forward, you know, it was just so encouraging to us.
Mm-hmm. Psalm 2:12 says, "Blessed are all those who put their trust in him." And then Matthew 6:26-34, "Consider the birds of the sky. They don't sow or reap or gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Aren't you worth more than they? Can any of you add one moment to his lifespan by worry? And why do you worry about clothes? Observe how the wildflowers of the field grow. They don't labor or spin thread. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was adorned like one of these. If that's how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and thrown into the furnace tomorrow, won't he do much more for you, O you of little faith? So don't worry saying, 'What will we eat?' or 'What will we drink?' or 'What will we wear?' For the Gentiles seek eagerly after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be provided for you. Therefore, don't worry about tomorrow, because tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough evil."
That was a scripture that just was highlighted to me. I even shared it with BJ and Christina. It's like, Yahweh says he will provide for us, he will hold us with his right hand, and to take it day by day and not to worry and to fret. And it does have enough worry of its own, but if we're looking to him, then we don't have to worry. Hebrews 10:23-25. "Let us hold on to the confession of our hope without wavering, since he who promised is faithful. And let us consider one another in order to provoke love and good works, not neglecting to gather together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging each other, and all the more as you see the day approaching."
So we wanted this message to be both just kind of a highlighting of things that we already know, but just setting some things in stone and just putting it out there again, because we have to have a target or we won't hit the mark. I mean, you can shoot at anything and hit it exactly in the middle every time, but it didn't get you anywhere. So we wanted to put a target out there. We wanted to give encouragement. And we, above all, want everyone to leave here looking forward to the way that he will provide for you and your unique needs that you're searching for, seeking for, praying for, whatever the case may be. You know, there's people that are trying to move here. There's people that are trying to all kinds of things. And I just want every person here to grab onto the fact that Yahweh sees you, sees your needs, and that he owns it all. He provided for your pain. He provided for redemption. He owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. He owns the world. He owns us. And he's not going to not take care of his people. So I want to leave you. I do this almost every time. I grew up watching my grandpa, for those of you that haven't heard me say this, in a culture that didn't often raise their hands. But my grandpa would raise his hands over the congregation and pray the benediction over them from Jude. Now unto him who is able to protect you from stumbling and to make you stand in the presence of his glory without blemish and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Yeshua, our Lord, be glory and majesty, power and authority, before all time, now and forever. Amen.
All together, sound the great shofar for our freedom. Raise the banner together, our exiles, and gather us together from the four corners of the earth. Praised are you, O Yahweh, who gathers in the dispersed of your people, Israel. Amen, amen. Now prayer for the United States of America all together. Abba, Father, giver of life, we pray for and entrust the United States of America to your loving care. You are the rock on which this nation was founded. You alone are the true source of life, liberty, and blessings. We cry out for this land to be reclaimed for your glory. May it be that you will dwell among your people. Send your spirit to touch and open the hearts of our nation and its leaders to seek your will and your ways. Grant us the ability and courage to stand for the truth, and may we be that righteous nation you have called us to be. We ask this in the name of Yeshua, our Messiah. Amen. Psalm 122, all together, prayer for the peace of Jerusalem. I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of Yahweh. Our feet are standing within your gates, O Jerusalem. Jerusalem that is built as a city that is compact together, to which the tribes go up. Even the tribes of Yahweh, an ordinance for Israel, to give thanks to the name of Yahweh, for there thrones were set for judgment, the thrones of the house of David. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they prosper who love you. May peace be within your walls and prosperity within your palaces. For the sake of my brothers and my friends, I will now say, may peace be within you. For the sake of the house of Yahweh our Elohim, I will seek your good."
The Aaronic Benediction. Yivarechecha Adonai v'yishmerecha. Ya'er Adonai p'nav alecha v'yikunecha. Yisa Adonai p'nav alecha v'yisem lecha shalom. May Yahweh bless you and keep you.
Amen.
May Yahweh cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you.
Amen.
May Yahweh lift his countenance upon you and give you shalom, peace.
Amen.
And it's time for the Kiddush, the blessing over the wine. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, borei pri hagafen. Amen. Blessed are you, Yahweh our Elohim, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine, and forgiving us, Yeshua the Messiah, who said, "I am the vine, you are the branches." And the blessing over the bread. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, hamotzi lechem min haaretz. Amen. Blessed are you, O Yahweh our Elohim, King of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth, and forgiving us, Yeshua the Messiah, who said, "I am the bread of life."
It is Shabbat, thank the Lord. It is Shabbat, thank the Lord. It is Shabbat, thank the Lord. It is Shabbat, it is Shabbat. Thank the Lord. It is Shabbat.